Sir, can you hear me? Good morning. And welcome to the server of Apache Dim. Before we start, who already uses or knows Spark, Flink, MapReduce on this server? Spark? MapReduce? Okay. Or Flink? Now some Flink users? So we are talking about big data and data processing. So it's not related to a previous talk, not directly. But we may have to find some, let's say, similar concept. So before we start, I'm JD. I'm software and architect at Tenet. And I'm also Apache Software Foundation member. And I'm working on around, let's say, roughly 20 Apache projects. So before we start digging into Apache Dim, we're going to talk about data processing. Okay, previously Christian talked about Kama and the file, but you can implement some EIPs, some messaging processing on this stuff. It's a bit like this, but we don't talk about messages, we talk about data. And imagine we use the JVCM application on mobile. So the one that was done this morning. So when you use this mobile application, you send a lot of events that you want to use to create some kind of analytics. So you want to know how many kind of events. So let's say we have three kind of events, green, yellow, and red. And we want to know the number of people, the number of users that create such kind of we want to do it batch, so every night, every month, every week, or whatever. Or we want to do it by streaming, meaning on the phone, okay, as soon as we have data. So when we talk about this kind of application, so let's say you create your own application on mobile, of course we have a lot of data. So any action on the mobile application really, so it means that we receive a lot of data. And actually, we receive a lot of data. The more the users use the application, the more we have data. And at some point, we receive so much data that we have to create some kind of chunk of data. For example, daily data. Okay, so we have data from Thursday, Wednesday, and Tuesday. But actually, at the end, hopefully our application will be really used a lot. And so we will have infinite data. So it means that daily, or let's say every minute, we have a lot of data coming into our system. So at some point, we may have some delay in the data. It's the difference between the data when I process the data and the time where the data has been created. Okay, for instance, let's say the red event. It occurs at 8 a.m. and I receive the event quite in the same time. So it means that the creation time and the processing time are basically the same. Now, we have another kind of event, like the green event, that has been created at 8 a.m., that actually I receive at 8:30. Because, for instance, this event has been created in the US. So due to some network congestion, or let's say network issue, or whatever, I may have some delay when I receive my data. And on the other hand, I can have at 2 p.m., I can receive the data that I've been created at 8 a.m. For example, I'm on mobile phone, I have an offline mode. So I go to a camp, I don't know if you're in the wood and I don't have any network connection, or I'm on a plane, transatlantic plane, and so I don't have any network connection. So my event will be sent to my system at 2 p.m., whereas the event itself has been created at 8 a.m. So it's what we name late arrival. All this stuff, you may have to deal with such kind of data, depending on the use cases. And by use cases, we have to address three concepts. The first one is completeness. It means that you have to get the entire amount of data before processing, or just a part of the sampling of my data is enough. or I may want to deal with latency. Latency meaning that when I can start to process my data and give an answer, give a result, and how fast can I need to provide this result. And the cost of it. More I have data, more it costs. These concepts depend on the use cases. It's up to you to decide, depending on the use case, what part of this concern you have to address. Let's take some examples. You want to implement a billing pipeline. So let's say on my mobile application, I have some ads, you know, some advertising. So every month, I have to send a bill to my, I don't know, Zalando, for instance, if it's an advertiser. I have to send a billing of all number of, let's say, advertising that part of my application. So the most important part is the content mix, because I would like to, for this month, to be able to address any data that I receive coming from this provider. Low latency doesn't really matter. Okay, I can run this batch every month. The most important is to get all the data. Low cost. Of course, it's a billing. So even if this pipeline was a bit, it doesn't really matter. Another use case is about estimate, billing estimation that pipeline. So here we talk about the user, so your user has to pay to use your application, and you want to give them the future billing that they will have. For example, if you use Amazon, you can see that when you use Amazon Cloud Platform, you have an estimation of your monthly cost. It's exactly this. Here, you can see that completeness is less important, because we will have a minimal sampling of the number of, you know, of the data. And you will have some prediction for the future end of the month. Low latency is really important, because of course, your user can wait for hours to get just an estimation of the cost. They just want to get the estimation now. And the low cost is also very important, because you don't want to impact your system just to, with pipeline, just to estimate the cost. Another thing that you may imagine as a pipeline is an abuse detection system. So on your mobile application, you want to detect when some users do some weird behavior. So basically, they produce, let's say, bad data. So here, contentless doesn't really matter, because you will estimate only on a chunk of data, not the entire data. But the low latency is really, really important, because you want to block the user as fast as you can. So here you can see that the concerns that we have to address are not the same. The latest one is the detection backfeed pipeline. So here is a pipeline that is a kind of expert system. So you want to improve your detection algorithm on the fly, using the previous data. So here, completeness is more important, because you want to get the history of data. Low latency doesn't really matter, because it's just to improve the algorithm that it's used on the fly. So the most important is, I would like to get an sampling of my data, and I would like to be very fast in terms of execution of this pipeline. And of course, the cost. It's just to improve my algorithm. I don't change my algorithm itself, so the cost is really important. Starting from these use cases, it's what we try to address with DIP, to answer these different use cases. And let's take a look on the evolution of the programming model. So some of you use MapReduce. It's where we started, actually. The first is you have some batch processing where you prepare some data. First, you apply a mapping, so the mapping is a transformation of the data from one state to another. And the result of the mapping is sent from a shuffle to all the system, all the machines, that execute a reduce task. So thanks to that, you can address any kind of big data processing. But it's mostly batch mode, okay? Because you have to execute on some part of the data. So very soon, you can imagine of these cases is, instead of directly using MapReduce, you may want to use an API on top of MapReduce. At Google, they created Flume. Flume is nothing more than some combination function on top of MapReduce. So we have the rule, we will create MapReduce function again. But it will orchestrate the function to create a simple API to archive views. Again, with MapReduce, you do something like this. So you have any kind of data that you want to structure, so to transform something that you know, key value pair, for instance. Okay, or transform from one kind of key value to something like another key value. That's the first purpose of MapReduce. Of course, you can imagine to do it by day. So every day, you run exactly the MapReduce job because you want to take sampling a chunk of data for a daily activity. So it's exactly the same. Very soon, you can imagine to have result and mapping per function. So instead of taking all the data, you chain a lot of mapping and reduction tasks to create some sub-chunk of data. And at the end, you can imagine session. So session here, we don't talk about the time of the data, we talk about the content of the data. So you want to group the data, so group by something. You want to group the data depending on the form and the content of the data itself. Session is not easy because you may have some overlap and, let's say, conflict between the time of the data and the session used by the data, the state of the data. And very soon you can implement something like, instead of executing my daily batch, I would like to process my data on the fly. So as soon as I receive the data, I would like to execute some processing. It's what we name streaming. So for the one who knows streaming in Java, streaming in big data is nothing related. Okay? When we talk about streaming, it's more always up and running processing. Okay? At Google, they create some kind of framework to do like this. The name is NeoAudience. Did you know NeoAudience? It has been published at Google, and the implementation is only at Google. And now in Bill, we have part of NeoWheel in the program model. So NeoWheel is nothing more than a streaming processing like you can do using Spark Streaming, and when you use the DStream in Spark Streaming, or when you use Flink and you use the data stream, it's exactly the same. So it's a data, it's a graph that is always ready. Okay. And thanks to that, you can implement something like this, so filtering and streaming on streaming data. So you still receive data on the file, and you can apply some transformation. Like this, you can implement streaming with aggregate time windows. So instead of processing each data when you receive it, you can group the data by a window. So the window, for instance, is the time. So you want to process your data on the fly, but group by every hour. So you create all the hour data processing. You can create also daily data, whatever. The grouping is performed by the MapReduce or live processing engine. You can also create even time-based window. So as I said, there's a difference between the creation of the data and the processing of the data. So it's up to you. Here, you can see that in my input, I receive some data at noon and a half, and actually I use it in a window from 11. Then you can do it. And another thing that you can do is a session window again. So in addition to the time base of the data, you can group the data per state. So depending on the state, you can use it as half of user or whatever. The difference between when the event is created and when it's received is what we name the ideal line. And basically the gap between the two is named the skew, and it's the watermark. So the difference between the event time and the processing time is basically the watermark. Right now, for the one who uses Flink, you can already do it. For the one who uses Spark, it's not possible in Spark now. Will be possible in Spark 2. But with the deep learning model, you will see that you can address this. every IO, every source of the data, deal with the water node. So you have a difference between the processing and the event creation. And basically, streaming batch is a question of completeness, low cost, and latency. So why do we use two different API to do that? I mean, basically, it's the same. The fact that you run in batch or streaming, at the end of the loop, it's exactly the same function that you're going to use. So Spark decides to use two different, let's say, artifacts. Spark Core, which is batch mode, and Spark Streaming, which is streaming mode. Flink used directly the big model, where both are implemented using exactly the same code. The fact that you use batch streaming is up to you in your pipeline. But the same code can work in batch streaming. And actually, B, Apache B means batch and streaming. The B for batch and B for streaming. It's where it comes from. And where it comes from behind the loop, the first in 2003. In 2003, we have MapReduce paper provided by Google. So Google created the MapReduce paper. But the implementation has been made at Google. It was not public. On the other hand, we have some Apache project implementing MapReduce. Hadoop, Lake Yarn, all this stuff. But now both Google and Apache projects join together to provide Apache. So Apache B comes from Google. For the one who knows Google Cloud Dataflow SDK, it's basically the B SDK. Okay. So it means that Google decided to give the SDK to Apache and to have the same parent model covering any kind of framework and execution runtime that you're going to use. And the question that you ask when you use Bit is what results are you creating? What kind of function you may want to use? Analytics, filtering, good bad value, map elements, goodbye key, all this stuff. Where the event time is computed. So is it an event time, is it the processing time, what's the water map that I'm going to use? Where the processing time are materialized, so the water map, the difference between the processing and the creation, and how do you refine the result? That's the question that you address using the BIM model. And thanks to that, using this BIM model, you can address these different use cases. Classic batch, as you can do with MapReduce, nothing changed there. If you use MapReduce, you can implement exactly the same using Git. But you can also do window batch, so grouping batch by event, by session, whatever, or data window. You can implement streaming, and you can implement streaming plus accumulation. So streaming with a window based on the time, or streaming plus a window based on the date. All of these use cases can be implemented exactly the same using Git, the same code. And so what is Apache Beam finally? Because I talked about Beam since the beginning, but what is Beam? So Beam is an agnostic programming model addressing both batch and streaming. It provides an SDK, so it means that you can use Java, you can use Python, you can use Scala to implement your Beam parent model. And more interesting maybe for you is that some that use MapReduce, all that use Flink. If you want to migrate from MapReduce to Flink, for instance, you have to rewrite your code. So it can be a lot of effort, it can cost a lot. With Beam, you just learn one SDK, and we provide runners that translate this parent model into an execution runtime. So exactly the same code, we run on Spark, we run on Flink, we run on MapReduce. And it's what I'm going to show you in the demo. In the demo, exactly the same code we learn on direct Spark and Flink. The runner that we provide right now is Apache Flink, Apache Spark, the Google Cloud Dataflow, which is a runner for the Google platform, the local, so that's very interesting. When you want to test your processing, you can run on a single JDM. Exactly as you can do on the cluster. will behave exactly the same. And there are some new runner on the fly, so there are a runner for GearPump, which is a streaming engine provided by Intel. There is one for MapReduce, it must be done. I just have to put some heat, but it must be done. And one for AGI, so in parallel. So you can run your data processing pipelines in your JVM using your AGI. And why Apache? First is Portillo. Exactly the same code we run in different, let's say, backend. It's unified, the same code for batch and streaming. The difference will be in the source of the data. You can have source with bounded data or unbounded data. Advanced feature, so it means that you can implement event window triggering, watermarking, and all this stuff using Beam. Be careful, some runners won't be able to implement the complete parallel model. Let me take an example. I said that using Beam, I can implement streaming with session window. This model is not supported by Spark 1.0. So if you implement something like this in your Beam and you run into Flink, it will work. If you run exactly the same in Spark, it won't run. It will say, no, it's not supported by the execution runtime. And it's normal because the Beam model is more advanced than the Spark model for now. Extensible model and SDK, you can create your own SDK on top of the Beam model. You can create your own DSS on top of the Beam model to simplify the way of writing your data processing. We address actually three kinds of users. The first users is the pipeline designers. So it's you basically. You want to write your data processing, so you will write some pipelines. For this, we provide the parallel model and the SDK, so you just directly use the SDK. But there are some other people that want to create their own SDK. So right now we provide Java and Scala. Imagine tomorrow you want to implement Akka language or Go language or whatever. In that case, you can create your own. You're going to use the runner API, the SDK API to create your own DSL. And of course, the runner writers. As I said, B by itself does not provide an execution on the own. It doesn't provide a runtime. I mean, when you use Spark, you have the SDK, the Spark API, and you have the execution on the own. Using B, we just provide the SDK. So it means that you have to create the translation from the model to the execution on the own. So let's say you have your own implementation, or maybe you use Storm, or you use Kafka Connect. You want to create a runner for Beam, so you're going to use the Beam language and translate it to Kafka Connect or Storm. You have to create a runner. So we provide a runner API, allowing you to create a runner very easily. This is the pipeline, basically. So a pipeline starts with a source. For the one that use Spark Streaming is for instance, Spark Streaming Kafka Soup, because now they use exactly the same wording as we use in Beam. Or when you use MapReduce, maybe it's an HDFS. So this is the source of the data. You send something to a set of transformation, mapping, reduction, filtering, group by key, or whatever. And at the end, eventually, you create an output, a basic output, what we never see. So you send to another Kafka topic, you send to another GFS file, whatever. That's a sync. So a pipeline is basically a die of transformation. The object that we transport into a pipeline is a P collection, a parallel collection. It's what you have from as an output of the transformation and an input of another transformation. A transform, you have three kinds of transformation. You have four basic transformation that you can use, group by key, filtering, so it's provided by the SDK, you just use it. You can create some composite transformation. So basically, you can imagine that map and reduce is a combination of both mapping and reduction tasks altogether. Or you can create your own transformation. It's what basically we're going to do in the demo. Very simple transformation. You also have a special kind of transformation is the I/O. You want to consume from, I don't know, Cassandra, and you want to send to Elasticsearch, this is our transform, because if consume from Cassandra and send into Elasticsearch. The P collection is basically a mutable collection where it doesn't support random access to the elements in the collection, and it's completely spread on the system. So every element in the P collection can be on some part of the cluster if you're in the cluster. Okay, it's really a parallel collection. This collection contains elements with a timestamp. Okay, it's by default. Vim will create the timestamp for you. If you don't provide one, you will use the creation time by default as a timestamp. It could be bonded or unbonded. Bonded means, for instance, I read some data from Cassandra or MongoDB. It will be a bonded collection because it is the number of records that I will read when I run my pipeline. If we talk about Kafka, Kafka will be unbonded by default because it will always listen for new message inside the token. So the same collection object can be used for bonded or unbonded streaming collection. You can also add some coders on top of the collection. Coders mean the way that you transform the data from one data format to another data format. For instance, if your collection from the JSON element or string element or key value pair. So basically, you can use Evro to convert any kind of data to another, to a size-able representation of the object. And in unbounded collection, you have all the windowing that you can apply directly to collection. So by windowing, meaning how you group, how you trigger the execution of the collection processing and all this. The IO, as I said, is in the previous talk, Christian talked about kernel components to connect from REST or to go to JMS, whatever. IO, you can say exactly the same for Vim. So it's a component that allows you to consume data from any kind of system and send data to any kind of system. By default, right now, we provide IO for Evro, JMS, MQTT, Kafka, of course, Elasticsearch, Cassandra, JDBC. But if you have any new IOs that you need, please be my guest and provide you to Vim project. It's not so easy to write an IO. I mean, in terms of code, it's not very complex. But the logic that you have to implement can be very complex depending on the watermarks, timestamps, and all this stuff. Okay. The fact that you can have late data removal, for instance, could be sometimes amazing. The SDK and DSL. The default SDK and the one that you're going to be using in the demo is the Java SDK. So using just Java code, you can implement the bypass. We have a Python SDK ready. And the Scala SDK should be done very soon. So the Scala SDK is provided by Spotify guys. They created a Scala SDK on top of the Vim SDK. And there are some of the SDK and DSL. I'm working with a labs in Ireland that want to provide an external DSL on top of the Vim SDK. The purpose for them is to simplify the way of writing code, just providing declarative DSL. Another SDK is by plan, not for this summer, but just after summer, is an SQL SDK. Like you have Spark SQL, you will have Beam SQL based on Apache Calcis. So with Calcis we discussed, and there are some interesting ways to create some SQL on top of it. This is an example of a very simple example of a Beam pipeline. So it's the classical work count. So you can see that I create a bad pipeline just using pipeline.create. And I retrieve some options. So the options are some arguments that you can provide on the command line, or when you spark submit or whatever. Once I have a pipeline, I use an IO, which is the text IO, but currently a text file line by line. Okay, I just read pipeline. Then I send, so this text IO read, return a P collection. A P collection of string. Each string is on the line. Okay, so I have deep collection strings, so I have and then I send to a function when I say transform. So this is a function that you can implement. And here what I'm going to do is just use line.split with a regex to extract all more in my line. And so here I'm going to have another key collection of string. But the string is not the line, it's each word in the line. Okay, so I start from key collection of string to another key collection of string. And then I send this key collection to the text I/O, but this time in write mode, so it will create a file for each word. Okay, so it's pretty stupid, okay, just to show you how it works. The demo is a little bit smart. But you can implement some advanced design like this. So it's exactly the same. You can see I retrieve some score. Let's say I use a game on my mobile phone. So I retrieve some score, and the format of the key collection resulting with this a key value pair of string and integer. So basically, what I would like to have is a key value pair with the name of the player and the score of the player. So string, integer. Here, what I would like to do is to group the score. I would like to have, for the last hour, the top score for each player. So it's something that I would do like this. Okay? I decide to use a session, but, oh, sorry, it's not for hours, it's for 2 minutes. So I would like to have, for the two last minutes, the top score. So let's say you want to bet on some soccer European Championship right now, and so you are a dead league or stuff like that, you can implement analysis like this on the phone. Okay, so you will have 2 minutes on the top score. You can see triggering here, you can see window by session, and the same can be applied for button or streaming. Here I can specify if I'm on button streaming. The fact that I'm using button streaming will depend to the IO that I'm going to use. So the runner are responsible for translating all my code that I show you into an execution runtime. So of course it won't be the same to run on Spark or to run on Spring. Okay? When I use Flink, I'm going to use master and slave. Spark is basically the same. But imagine with Google, it's completely different, with the Google data flow platform. So the runner are responsible to translate my code to the target execution on your end. So all this stuff is provided by the runners. By default, we provide 4 runners. Of course, the Google Cloud Dataflow, the Apache Flink, the Apache Spark, and we have 2 other runners. The local one, allowing you mostly to test on the local machine, and an OSGI Keras runner that allows you to run on any kind of Keras instances and OSGI instances. It's basically an extension of the direct runner, which is the local JVM. MapReduce is mostly done, and GitHub is also mostly done. The big advantage for you guys, you don't care about the execution of your model. You just write the model. You learn only one API. Switching from thing to spot, that's a big deal. You don't change your code. Okay, that's very interesting for you. So some use cases. Basically, any kind of big data processing that you can do using batch or streaming with unbodied or bundled data, and all the models that you can implement. So you can do ELT, ETL, analytics, patcher processing, data aggregation, claim check, complex event processing, all these use cases can be implemented using data. A real use case, so I will give you some names that already use BIM, because actually BIM is an integration project at Apache, but it's another project at Google. Maybe some of you use Spotify. All the recommendations that you receive on Spotify, like discover this album or this artist, use BIM. All is implemented using BIM. There are other like Netflix. Netflix starts to stream from Spark to BIM. I know that Zalando, I don't know where, but Zalando use BIM as well, mostly with a Google platform. So I mean, it's an incubation project. is a prediction rate problem. Do you have any questions now? Yeah? We see the demo and we can address the question. So the demo that I is very simple. What I wanted to show you is maybe you know GDLT data. You know, GDLT is any event in the world that happened, any news that happened in the world daily basis. So you have a file every day containing a CSV file containing all events that happen in the world. Even like there is a strike in France, as always. There is a strike in Barcelona in the subway. There is, for instance, there is some flooding in UK, stuff like that. So any big news are all together in the CSV file. So what I would like to do is to take this CSV file using the one daily file and extract the location of any event that happened for this day. So I would like to know how many events happened in Spain, happened in France, happened in the US. Okay, and apply some kind of filtering because I would like to avoid some bad data. Okay, so basically what I'm going to do is such kind of pipeline. I will show you the complete code because I'm going to execute it. But basically, I start from the text IO again because I would like to read my CSV file. So my CSV file for the demo will be located on my local machine, but of course, it will be on HDFS, it will be on S3, it will be wherever you want. Then I apply the first transformation, extract the location. So basically, for each line in the CSV, you have the time, the kind of event, the link describing the event, the country, the city, and all this stuff. So what I would like to do is to just extract the country. And then I would like to count the number of events per country. So I would do a map and then a reduce, basically. So here when I do count per location, I would have a key value pair with the name of the country and the number of events. So if I would like to send that to another file, another text file, I have to reformat this key value as a string. Key, column, for instance. So if we bring down, this is an example of the extract location. So I have a CSV file, remember? So I have my each line, so P collection of string, each element in the P collection is a line. So the first thing that I'm doing is parallel. Parallel means parallel do, meaning parallel processing. So it doesn't mean that this function will be executed on a single executor. It will be spread on the cluster, if I use a cluster. It doesn't get looked by the RAM. You don't have to care about this. So the parallel, and you give a function, do first. Do function. So my function is very basic. I receive some string, and I receive a P collection of string, and I return another P collection of string. The input P collection of string is the line. The output P collection of string is the location. So to do that, what I'm doing is I split my each line in fields. So I extract any word delimited with tabulation. Okay? Then I do some filtering, doesn't really matter. And you can see that in the output I extract a single field, which is the 21st, in the fields. And so this one I plug in the P collection. So I started with a P collection of line, and my output is P collection with Spain, France, US, Spain again, France, US, Australia. Okay. So then, what I have to do is to count all elements in the P collection with the same name. So I would like to count Spain, or France. So to do that, instead of creating my own, let's say, transform, I use an existing, this is not good. I will show you the code of the view. So the code is basically an existing function that I'm going to use, count.stringElement. And so it will automatically count the element for me. Then I send to a map element, so a mapping that ponders the key value pair, string, string long, like this, inside the string again, that I can send into my text type. So let's take a look at the demo. And I will show you that the same code we run on Spark in the first one, single JDK. Okay? Without checking anything. So let me show you. Is it better? Can you see that? No? Let me switch to cloud mode. Alright. So I prepare, let me show you what I prepare. So this is my pipeline. So the first thing that you can see, I created some pipeline options. So it's where you define the arguments that you can provide to the pipeline. So you can define the week using annotation, the day, the input, the output, the remainder. Okay, you just, it will be replaced with --input, --output when you execute the runtime. The runtime itself is here. So as I said, the first one, I use the text IO. Okay, the text IO with a deeper collection of line. Then I do an X-Fact location, and I transform my deeper collection of line into deeper collection of location. Then I do some filtering, okay, because I would like to avoid some bad data. So you can see that for the filtering, I use a ready-to-use transformation with a filter.by, and I provide a function. So I apply my filtering there. Then I directly use a count per element. So you can see I take the point per location, I directly take the decoration, and I point each element in the decoration. It's already providing transformation. Then I use a mapping to compare these key value pair inside the string, and I send to a writer. Okay, pretty simple. So now let's take a look on, let's say, the input file. Input file, input file. So this is an input file, okay? So you have, you know, it's a real one, okay? It's a real file that I use. So you have some events in the US, in Tokyo, in Japan, in Delhi, in India, etc. The purpose is just to extract this data. So let's run my sample. So it's just a Java application, a Java main class, so you just do java.jar. To simplify my laptop, I use Maven with the exec plugin, but basically it's the same. So let's say first, I run something like, so I create some profiles to define the runners that I would like to use. So the first execution that I'm going to do is using the direct run, which is a single JVM run. So I just provide direct. So I provide the main class, okay, which is basically my path type. Events by location. And I provide some arcs like, so input, which is the location of my CSV file. And I don't remember the name. And I provide the output. This. I run. So you can see some execution, some output like SDK, IO write, the backend and all this stuff. So it's the pure direct pipeline run. Okay, it works. Now if I go into my output, you can see a bunch of files being created. And if I do span, we have 149 events happening in Spain for this day. Okay? It was with a direct run. Without changing anything, without recompiling, I'm going to run on Spark. So exactly the same thing. You can see that I reuse the same syntax. Just change the profile to retrieve the dependency for Spark. Okay? So it's not the direct runner as the Spark runner. And here I specify Spark pipeline reference. I this one, I didn't recompile, I just ran. And you can see that now the output is not the same at all. Because you can see all the Spark classes involved. Okay, so you can see the Spark listener bus, you can see the Spark UI starting and all this stuff. Okay, probably I will have some issue because Spark won't be stopped cleanly by the exec plugin, but it's not an issue. I need more. So now if I take a look, also I forgot to remove all the files. So I remove all the files and execute again. Well, exactly the same thing, using still Spark, okay? Using there. And now if you take a look in the output, you can see the output from Spark. Okay, it's slightly different from the direct runner, because I don't use the Spark runner, the same runner, okay? But the output is the same. So now if I take a look on this one, you can see that for Spain, I have exactly the same number of that I use the Spark run. And quickly I remove this, and this time I run not on Spark but on Flink. So I change the profile just to retrieve the dependency, and I run on the Flink pipeline run, so exactly the same code. So you can see that now Flink is executed. Here we can see, I think, Apple, default dispatcher, Flink pipeline run, all this stuff. And at the end, if I take a look, for Spain, I still have my 149 events, but not with a send account. So quickly, do you have any time for question and answers, I thought? So do you have any questions? So in terms of roadmap, just to give you an overview. Beam has been added to the Apache Incubator in February this year. The first release of Beam was last week. It should be TLP by the end of this year, hopefully. But it's already used a lot at Google. Do you have any question? Yes?
So essentially, machine learning can be used as a Fourier programming.
Yes.
So how do you compare it to direct Java? Does it cooperate with direct Java if you want to design one?
When you use the direct Java runner, the direct, let's say, runner, basically what it does to deal with a body prediction of all this stuff, to create a lot of stress internally. That's why it's not really for production, it's more for testing purposes. If you really want to go to production, I really advise you to use a Spark or Flink or any kind of, let's say, scalable runner. That's the point. basically, what we do in the direct pipeline runner is just create virtual thread. So if your peak variation is very large, you will have issues on your local machine. Other questions? Yeah? Thank you.